Let's just say you just created a homemade lithium-ion battery pack. And if you have no idea how to do this, then check out one of my previous videos. Anyway, my pack got 4 cells in series, with 2 cells in parallel each, which means it covers a voltage range of 16.8 to 12 volts, outputs up to 40 amps continuously, features a capacity of 5 amp hours, and thus a nominal energy of 72 watt hours. That means that after adding wires to the pack and adjusting its output voltage to constant 12 volts with a suitable converter, it is perfect for powering 12 volt devices. But such a naked battery pack is not 100% safe to work with. For example, if the battery pack got discharged, I can charge it up with an appropriate constant current, constant voltage methods. But during that process, I noticed that not all cells feature the exact same voltage. The reason is that not every cell is chemically identical, and thus they all feature slightly different capacities and thus charge up faster, which can lead to misalignments in the voltage of the cells, and ultimately in their destruction due to overvoltage. Or let's say the load failed and the battery got shorted, which I will certainly not try out, because battery shorts can do a lot of damage. To avert such safety problems, you can get yourself a BMS, or battery management system, from eBay for cheap. Those not only offer balanced charging and short circuit protection, but also overcharge and over-discharge protection. But since some viewers do not really trust such BMS circuits from eBay, and tons of viewers ask for DIY BMS, we will have a closer look at a commercial BMS and explain all of its functions, and then create a DIY BMS based on Stuart Pittaway's design, in order to find out whether you should go with the commercial version or go the DIY route instead. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by JLC PCB, where you can now get 10 PCBs in all available colors for the price of only $2. And new customers also get a shipping discount on their first order. To properly understand commercial BMS, I got myself a few different ones. The one I will have a closer look at will be the biggest one, which basically comes with all the protection features you need. After removing its top heatsink, as well as its bottom paper insulation, I examined these circuits and found out that the PCB is divided in 3 functional groups. So let's start off with the top side and the components closest to the balance connector, which, like the name implies, connects to each cell of the battery pack. By having a look at the components under the microscope, we can for once see a bunch of passive components, like capacitors and resistors, but also 2 transistors for each cell and 1 DW01A IC. This IC protects each cell from overcharge, overdischarge and overcurrent by simply utilizing 2 transistors, which we had a look at before, in order to cut the cell's connection to the load. By flipping the PCB around, we got more components near the balance connector, which once again were a couple of complementary passive components, and also once again a transistor, but this time in combination with some bigger 200 ohm resistors and a BB3A IC. Those markings on the IC are those of an HY2213 IC, which is a 1-cell lithium-ion LiPo balanced charge IC. As you can see in the example circuit of the datasheet, its job is to activate a transistor, which then discharges one battery cell through a resistor, as soon as the cell voltage goes above a certain voltage value. This way, after the charging process, all cells of the battery pack get charged up to 4.2 volts, and we got a balanced pack. Last but not least, on the top side of the PCB, right next to the B-, P- and C- terminal, where you would hook up the main wires of the battery pack, we got 6 P75, NF75 N-channel power MOSFETs, a couple of passive components with transistors, and 3 bigger resistors which act as a current shunt. The way this works is that as soon as the battery draws more than the BMS max current of 35 amps, we got a voltage drop high enough across the current shunt to activate the passive component network, and thus turn off the MOSFETs and therefore the current flow. This way, the 3 functional groups of this BMS fulfill all the required battery pack protection features. Pretty much all the other BMS followed the same PCB principle. The only thing that is different sometimes is that balanced charging is not included. And now that we know how a commercial BMS works and how much they cost on average, I thought about how to create an improved version. But while coming up with my own plan, I realized that a viewer recommended me to have a look at Colin Hickey or Adam Welsh's work for reference. They have built and created a couple of videos about the DIY BMS, which is a project from Stuart Pittaway that you can find on GitHub. After downloading its smaller PCB branch, which like the name implies comes with a smaller PCB than its regular version, I had a close look at the schematic of the PCB to find out how it works. First off, after hooking up a battery cell, this REC710NA regulator creates a stable 3.3 volts for the ADUM1250 I2C isolator and the ADTiny85 microcontroller. Through a voltage divider, the battery cell's raw voltage gets sampled and monitored by the ADTiny85, which every few seconds sends over this voltage value through its I2C bus to the I2C isolator, which is on the other side hooked up to an ESP8266 development board, which then provides this data for viewing through a web browser. But not only does this circuit monitor the voltage as well as the temperature of the battery cells through a thermistor, but it also got a MOSFET, which if the battery voltage needs to get lowered, connects it to a power resistor. So online monitoring and balancing is easily possible, which were improvements I was looking for. That is why I uploaded the gerbil files of the PCB to JLCPCB, in order to get 10 of them for $2 plus shipping, and afterwards started sourcing the required components. I got the majority of them from Mauser, and only a few, either too expensive or special ones, from eBay. So as soon as the components arrived, as well as the PCBs, which looked very nice, it was time for soldering. I basically used tons of flux, a microscope, and a fine soldering tip to solder all SMD components to the boards, according to the schematic, which was pretty easy to do. The only thing I messed up was that I ordered one component package size too big, which still worked for the resistors, but was not the best option for the capacitors. But nevertheless, after 3 hours of soldering, the SMD components of 4 PCBs were soldered on. Next, I added the big power resistors, as well as the female headers for programming, and the JST terminals for the battery and I2C lines to each board. For the ESP8266 board, I went with this node MCU, which I soldered onto a small piece of perf board, to which I also added a 4-pin JST terminal. Its pins connect to 3.3 volts, D1, D2 and ground of the ESP8266, which are mandatory for the I2C communication. To program the ESP, I simply hooked it up to my computer, opened the given code for it, selected the board settings like they were described in the code, and clicked upload. After successfully uploading the codes, it was time for the ADTiny boards, for which we only have an ICSP connector for programming. So I connected an Arduino Uno to my computer in order to upload the Arduino ISP sketch to it. Afterwards, I connected the Arduino Uno to the ICSP pins, like it is shown here, and continued by downloading the proper board library mentioned in the code, setting the correct board properties, burning the bootloader, which only sets the correct fuses of the ADTiny, and finally uploaded the code through the programmer, which worked like a charm. And as soon as all four boards were programmed, it was time for the assembly. I hooked up each battery cell pair to one PCB through a JST wire that I prepared beforehand. Once that was done, I connected the ESP8266 to power and firstly had to connect to it with my computer in order to enter its IP address in a browser to properly connect the ESP to my router. I then checked my router to determine the new IP address of the ESP and typed it in to properly connect to it. On the page we cannot see much yet, but by clicking modules we can hit the provision button after connecting the first PCB to the ESP through a 4-pin JST wire. After a few seconds we should see the first module with the measured voltage and temperature of the battery cell. After then repeating this connection and provision button hitting process 3 more times, we finally got all the modules recognized by the software, which looked pretty awesome so far. What I was missing though was a setting to set a maximum allowed voltage. Thankfully though, Colin Hickey improved the software, which on the bad side means I had to reprogram all the boards. But on the bright side means we got a maximum voltage setting plus a few more helpful settings. Now after properly calibrating the battery cell voltages, I set the maximum voltage to 4.1 volts and started charging the battery pack with my lab bench power supply. As you can see near the end of the charging process, the batteries exceeded this 4.1 volt value, and thus the boards balanced them out by drawing around 1 amp of current through their power resistors. So all in all, the DIY BMS seems to work fine, and offers with its online monitoring and balance charge function, features that commercial BMS do not offer. Only problem is that it is more expensive, takes up a bit of time to solder, and worst of all, draws quite a lot of current from each battery cell in comparison to commercial BMS. So the DIY BMS makes sense to use in combination with, for example, a DIY power wall, which gets charged up through solar power, but not for your regular battery pack, which sits around most of the time. Because of that, I declare that both DIY and buy are this time the winner, because when used for the right application, they offer their own advantages that the other version does not have. But what do you think? Let me know in the comment section below. As always, thanks for watching. Don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!